Super.
So welcome back for session 19 of CE, going 20C to 20C. Today is really more of a work session than it is kind of a formal presentation. What we're going to do is kind of talk a little about some different projects you're working on and some of the overall flow and organization of how you can sort of approach these things, sort of solve any specific sort of problems or answer some questions to help you get started along the way. But also, I did go through and work on an example based on the energy analysis node, because the energy analysis nodes a lot of people are sort of looking at trying to use. So we put together some basic Dynamo scripting that uses a little bit of Python in the background to go through and launch the GBXML, do the energy analysis. So I want to look at that together, because I think a lot of people will end up using that node as part of their project. Okay, so you know, we can walk through some of that as we get going. We can then like just turn it over to kind of think about how this could apply to your projects, or take a look at any kind of specific issues you're thinking about in terms of when do you flex, when do you kind of create new population members, how do you evaluate, you know, the correct order of all those things. But really that is to kind of just get you as ready as possible just in terms of thinking about your own projects. Now, in terms of thinking about Thursday, what's going on, Thursday is really not necessarily your project being completed, it's just kind of a check-in where you're going to share what you're working on, whatever progress you've made, like with other folks, just so everyone can sort of see what it is, have a chance to sort of pivot and help you debug some different things. So go into that not thinking about it being a presentation with a deck of slides and all that type of stuff. It's pretty much, hey, you have your example mapped out, you probably have a Revit model that you're testing, you may have some Dynamo scripting that's partially complete, but not all the way complete, but it's really more sharing, because you know, there's so few of us, we can might as well just like use it as a joint session in terms of doing all that. So don't worry, some people are further along, some people are not as far along, that's okay, just sort of share what you have, and you know, there's no judgment. So let's just go ahead and put it out there, the idea is to kind of help each other get through this all. So in terms of the session 19 Dynamo examples, if you want to download that, what I want to start with is just going ahead and taking a look at, really, it's the overall flow for how you approach something like this and how you go from having sort of a simple evaluator that can evaluate one thing, sort of scaling it up, start thinking about applying it to a whole population of things. Okay, but in particular, the evaluator for energy was kind of a weird one in that there was a little bit of work that was necessary to pull it all together. So that's what I want to share with you first. Oh, is it not up there yet? Did I put it in the wrong place? It's 120C, it's 19. Did I see it right there?
Is it published?
I think I did. Let's kind of see what's going on here. Let me go out to files again.
I'll try
it out. 19 here. Oh, where did I put them? That's interesting. Maybe I put, hang on.
They got to it by going to the session 1849.
It's interesting, now it's just kind of being sort of weird. Hang on. Everything's just being a little strange right now. Okay, 19. Okay, there they are. It looks like it's published right now. Go ahead and do a refresh and see if you can get it to it now.
Yeah, I see that.
Okay, great. Go ahead and download that. Stop. Today we're going to talk about the energy node and kind of the overall approach. And I'm saying for Thursday, don't think about it as being the final and all has to be done. It's really more like we're going to share work in progress at that point and help each other out in terms of, oh, you're trying to do that? Have you considered? And a little bit of kibitzing like that. Okay, so if you want to download those, what you can find in there, there's really just one example with all those energy nodes. The 19?
Yeah.
Give it a refresh. Everyone sort of had that problem for a little bit. Jacqueline, did you get it? Okay. But just not dumb. Give it a refresh. Okay, Elena, you got it?
Yeah.
Okay. No worries. As we're going, let's just go ahead and start talking about how we're going to approach this whole problem. In general, there really is kind of an organization to a project like this and how you might want to approach it. And it really almost goes in three separate phases with some sub-pieces within there. But at a high level, you're doing something like this. Yeah, you're going through, and at some level, you're creating just a range of different input values. So over here, we're just going to put some inputs in there. And whether those are sort of static values or a list of values or combinations of values or whatever, you're going to create some different inputs that we're going to go through and test. Okay. The second step in the whole process typically is we're going to go through and do some sort of just basically adapting of a Revit model. So in this whole step, what we're really all about is just basically changing the Revit model, flex the Revit model. We have to do something that's going to go through and just change it, okay, in response to those inputs. So those inputs are going to go in, you're going to make some sort of changes. Okay. After we go through and change that Revit model, what you're going to do is go through and evaluate it. So again, we'll do something like this. We'll say that we're going to evaluate, and then we'll sort of subdivide and conquer here a little bit. Pull you back up there. Don't want that? Come back over here. Okay. Well, so much for my spelling. You'll get the idea. Okay. Once you're going up there and you have your inputs, you have your Revit model and you're evaluating, so wrong. There's a couple different things you need to go through and like do along the way. One thing we need to do when we're flexing the Revit model is because we're going to go through and set this up on a loop that's going to automate things, it can race ahead and try to evaluate before you're done flexing the Revit model. So we're going to get into this whole notion of that within every loop, every time we go through and do this, we always want to go through and update the Revit model. And the way we do that is we have a little transaction start and we have a little transaction end at the beginning and the end of all these things. So over here, we're always going to go through and do a start. I'm very bad about that. Okay, it's back over here. Over here, we're always going to do an end. Okay. And in between those things, generally what we're going to do is a bunch of sets. We're going to do some sort of parameter setting. So within the middle of that block, you tend to have a lot of just element, set parameter by name. And that's how you're going through doing your flexing. Okay, so the big thing is you got to have that start and the end. That's critical because you need to have the end complete so that the transaction is done, the Revit model generates before you actually start your evaluation. That way you're getting what you need for every individual case. Okay. When you get over to the evaluation block, there really can be all sorts of different nodes kind of hanging around in here. We can have eval 1, eval 2, eval 3. And really, all these things are different things that you want to go through and consider. So for example, if I want to basically sort of say, get the EUI as one of my evaluators, okay, I'll have that as one block. If I want to have another evaluator that is something like, get the average luminosity, I get something like that. So I just have different evaluators. And out of those, different results are going to be reported. But the big thing is, it's always take your inputs, kind of do whatever you're doing in here, okay? Make sure they're all complete, okay? And then that Revit model is going in as the input to the evaluators. Okay, out of the tail end of all that, after you do your evaluations, you could just be writing a CSV file or an Excel data file, just whatever you want. Or you can pull those back in and use them to help generate data generation. It just kind of depends on what overall control scheme you're trying to use. Okay, so if We're going to start this by doing it for a single input. Okay, so case one is, we'll just do that for a single input. Yeah, case two is we'll do that for a list. Okay, and if we're going to do it for a list, we're going to do the same thing as case one, but what we're going to need to do is basically go through and encapsulate all of this stuff into one big node and use a list map to go through and drive it. So if we're going through and doing case two, what I'll do is I'll just take all that stuff right in here. And make a big node out of it. Okay. The inputs are going to be kind of whatever parameters we're going to feed in. All this stuff is going to happen inside the node, and it's all going to be driven by a list map, which is going to go through and evaluate 1, 2, 3, 4 of those different things. And that's what we'll demonstrate today, is really how you work through that sort of procedure. If we can get that to work, we have a list. Okay, and then on the outside of this thing, we have a list map. Then what's going to happen is this function is going to be the part that comes in as the f of x. You're going to have a list that comes in here too. Okay, and that'll be this list. So the way we're going to make the list map work is we just need to go through and sever that. So there's an open input, and then the list map will go through and do that. Again, that's sort of what we've been playing with all along. But let's go ahead and work it through with a specific example with the EUI, and the, we can go through and make another node for the lumens or something like that. But let's kind of pause there for a second. Does this sort of scheme kind of make sense about what you're up to? So start with one and build up a list, and then if we get really fancy, then go through and kind of vary two different variables and let Dynamo go ahead and generate the list. Okay, great. Let's go ahead, if you can, open up exercise 19. Or example 19.1, 1A. Looks something like this, and let's just kind of take a look at what's going on in here. Right now, this is all set up just as a single case. We're just sort of running the energy analysis. And I would say start with that. Before you get into a lot of list mapping and custom nodes, see if you can get it to work at a high level. And what's happening in this example, let me just kind of close the Dynamo for you for right now, is I have a nice little Revit model kind of hanging out there. Yeah, in this Revit model, oh, it's just a little building. We could go through and flex anything we want to about this. Yeah, going through and, oh, we can go through and change sort of the windows that are on the opposite side. This one I said more from the standpoint of kind of thinking about just the illumination that was in there. But if, for example, I wanted to go through and, for a certain window over here, I can go through and change something about its parameters. I can change the parameters, the type parameter, so that as opposed to being 36 inches wide, it's 48 inches wide or something like that. Let's go ahead and just do it as a single thing first, and then we'll like figure out how we go through and change that parameter. Okay, so you have this little model hanging around. Excellent. Okay, now, as you go through and think about doing anything with some automation, the important thing to start out with is just realizing, you know, will it work if you do it manually? Because if it won't work manually, then it won't work with the automation. Okay, and as I was playing with this and playing with OnGod yesterday to try and figure out how to get this node to work, you know, having different errors, different things were sort of working. And it turns out a lot of what was going on is that just we didn't have the model set up right. So we had to go through and make sure the model was set up right to do some energy analysis. So if you're doing energy analysis in your model, the big things to consider are you need to have rooms in your model. The energy analysis tools like rooms. So this one does have a room. Okay, the room is currently going up to 15 feet. That way it hits the ceiling and it's capped off. That's kind of cool. It shows what's going on. The other thing that we needed to do just to make sure it was going to work was to go through and turn on volume calculations, not just area calculations. And the way Revit works just to sort of save itself some bandwidth is typically it only turns on area calculations, which are a little bit faster because it only has to sort of consider the XY plane. It doesn't have to go up to the Z. But when we try to go through and export this, okay, to the energy analysis package, it'll complain at us. And let's just kind of show you sort of what happens, if we don't automatically sort of say just run the energy analysis, how we're going to do it, you know, in terms of doing the scripting. When we go up and we say that we want to analyze this, and we'll look at our energy settings. So great, you sort of say what it is, it's an office or it's a classroom, whatever you want. We could say what sort of export category we're going to use. And if we're using rooms, then we'll use rooms. If you're using spaces, we'll use spaces. Just kind of have to make sure that's consistent with what you put in there. Okay. We're going to say use the building elements as opposed to conceptual masses, because we actually have the detail. If you aren't looking at sort of detailed model, you're just looking at masses, switch that over that way. Okay. Whatever you have set up here will be what actually kind of carries forward. Because when we say launch the energy analysis, it just does whatever it says to do here. Okay. As we get going, what happens is if you say that you want to export the GBXML, which is really what we're going to do automatically, it'll even warn you. It's like, hey, okay, there's an error here. Yeah, what's telling me is we've only computed the areas, we haven't actually considered the volume, so it's giving me the error that was actually, was really flummoxing me, and I'm going there, look, what's wrong with this thing? It just won't analyze. And that's really the error that we were encountering. So try to do it manually first, just to see if you can get it to go. Okay. So do you want to enable? And I'll say yes. Okay. At that point, you could even see what the little GBXML model looks like. That's kind of looking pretty good there. Okay, so this is the model that's actually going to be exported and analyzed. So just make sure it's there. If you want to, you can go ahead and save this away. Now try saving this somewhere on your desktop.
Where did you get the export GBXL?
Sure, let's find that again. It's under the file or the application menu. And there's an export choice. Then there's export GBXML. Let me save that setting. Export. Beautiful. Now, if you're just doing conceptual masses, there's another choice that says export conceptual GBXML. Okay, and that's sort of massive GBXML. I think it's conceptual. Yeah, that's going to work fine there. It's just, you know, either case, it's whether it's going to consider the actual building elements or whether it's just going to do the shape of the masses and apply some parameters. But if that is actually working, let's go ahead and let's say next and try saving that away. We're actually going to create a directory somewhere in our system just so we can put all these GBXML files, because our script is going to need that too. So what I actually did was I created a little directory. Oh, I just put it on my desktop and created a folder called GBXML, just a place to stash these things. But why don't you go ahead and kind of come up with that same sort of path just somewhere on your system, because we're going to need that in a little bit. We're going to have to put that path into the export node. So I'm just going users, Blinkcast, desktop, GBXML. If you want, I'm just going to put it under your user desktop. Some sort of folder out there. If you need to create a new folder, you can do that. But we're just going to try just doing a manual export. I'll just call this manual export 2, or in class. Save that away. Okay, we just want to make sure that it actually does export, because if it ain't exporting, then the automation isn't going to work. We have to be able to do it that way. So if you want to take a look at what that did, I'll go out to my little GBXML class or folder on the desktop, and you'll see. There's that little manual export. If you even want to sort of see what this looks like, you can. It's just basically a description of the building. What Revit does, and what the energy analysis does, is it actually just goes through and first loads up some general location information and some overall building information. Then it just loads up a whole series of different planes which describe your building. This is a series of flat planes. And then uses that for doing the analysis. A little bit further in the file, it goes through and associates all those different planes with different temperature profiles, material profiles. Okay. But that's the file we're after. Okay, so go ahead and close that up. Because what we want to do is basically get the program to do that manually for us, or automatically for us. Just so you get a sense of really what's happening, go ahead and, if you can, export one of these ones manually, just so you have something. That way you can sort of follow along. To follow it all the way through, what I'm going to do is go over to Green Building Studio. It's actually the tool that does the analysis in the background when we send it off for energy analysis, and load that thing in. Okay. So, and it's a good thing to do because you can sort of test to see, were there any errors? Because you want to see what those errors are in your face, as opposed to having them hide behind in the background somewhere. So if you have an XML file out there, do this if you can. Go to I'm going to go to, like, in this case, Chrome. I'll go to gbs.autodesk.com. Go ahead and log myself in here. Okay, if you can log in super, if you're having any trouble logging in, that has something to do with your Autodesk ID and whether or not GBS is enabled for you, I think it should work. Go ahead and try that and see if you can get in here. Because we'll need to have access to the service in order to do the energy analysis. So again, I'll come on in here. Beautiful. So, are you able to get into Green Building Studio? Let's start with that. Excellent. Good. What's it? Okay, good. Excellent. Because what we're going to do is, if you can even sort of imagine, if we're going to walk through the whole procedure kind of manually, we're going to create a new project. It's going to be called, session, I'll call it 19 in class. You can sort of say a little about what it is, although that's going to come out of your GBXML file in just a minute. It's funny, I never go back and do it this way. Oh geez, let's see if I can ask the project location. If you put it in totally manually, you have to actually do this, which is actually a little funny, because typically this all comes as part of the GBXML. Created a new project, almost, continue. Yes, I'm authorized.
What is the building type?
The building type is like whether it's office or classroom, or it's, in Revit, we always go through and pick it just in the top of the energy settings menu. And what it does, it says something about the number of people per square feet and the typical operating hours.
Stop,
what you got?
I
had
that,
like,
manual,
but let's see what you got. Okay, so you're creating. Say continue. Choose
okay.
No worries. Now, the weird thing is, we never see this interface because we're always just going ahead and sending it out of Revit. And in Revit, you've done all these things. You've chosen the building type and your energy settings dialog. You told it where the project's going to be. But this is actually what's in the background. For this, go ahead and say, let's say, do not share any data, share only, say share all project data. Contact preference, do not contact me. You don't want people calling you.
No.
And yes, I am authorized to share this, the middle one. Great, okay, so you have the basics in there. You have a shell for the project, okay. Now let's go ahead and upload that GBXML file to it. This is, again, what we're going to automate in just a second. But you can say upload the GBXML file. And I can go out and grab that XML file and say upload it. And again, this is just testing. We're just making sure our infrastructure is in place. Because in just a moment, we'll never look at this again. We're going to do this all in an automatic way, just using the scripting. But I just want to make sure that for this model of AutoFlex, I can get it up to that site. You can see it's going to go through and do some analysis. It's got a floor area. It's going to go through and compute an energy use intensity. It's going to run the DOE 2.2 simulation. It's doing a lot of stuff in the background. And super. You'll actually see what it does. Notice that it went through and started creating one. You might notice that it's creating a bunch of alternates right now. What GBXML does, or what Green Building Studio does, is it takes everything that you give it and says, hey, well, those are a pretty good group of assumptions. What if I took most of the key variables and I diffed? I'll go plus and minus from the values you've chosen to sort of show you a range of different options that are available. And if you, in the B class, been playing around with the Insight tool, that's just how it does it. It just basically generates a whole range of options, it tests them all, and then it puts it back in sort of a nice graphical form to give you a sense of like what the results are. So super. Looks like for a bunch of different variations, I run through some different EUIs. You notice the uninsulated one has an EUI of 73.7. There's some other ones where it's different window to wall ratios. There's different levels of insulation. It just goes ahead and considers a lot of options. Okay, but see if you get that part working. If you got that part working, then your infrastructure's in place and we're ready to automate. Okay, so you got some stuff running in the background there? Excellent. Okay, in that case, we are ready to automate this procedure. And how we do that is go on back over to Revit, and we'll go over to Dynamo and take a look at basically a script or a single graph that'll do most of what we just did there. Let's say add-ins, go to Dynamo, and if you open up 1A in 19.1, this is my little adaptation. All these different things that are floating around in here besides 1A, those are the original examples that came with the plugin, with Thornton Thomas City. Plug in everything that's kind of put there for you. But we sort of put a very simple path in 1A. That'll sort of like be a good starting point for us. Where, let's take a look at what's in here. Starting over on the left-hand side, we have basically we're going to create a new GBS project and get the project ID or get a list of prior IDs. So this part right up here, run analysis, create project, that's exactly what we did when we were in Green Building Studio and we went through and just started running through and created a new project. So if you want to create a new Green Building Studio project, you can put a different name in there. So let's go ahead in there, and I'll just put session 19, automated. Okay, so that's just going to be a string that's going to go into, there's a node called run analysis create project. That just says, whatever you're logged into now in Green Building Studio, we're going to go through and create a project for you just a placeholder for some runs. If you already have some existing runs, you can associate, or a project, you can associate the new runs with it, but I'm going to use that one right now. The second part of this is really just, this is the name of a file we're going to create. And remember, we created in a folder, the GBXML folder. We created something called GBXML export manual or something like that. I'm going to go through and give this a name, like automated one. just so I can sort of spot the file. This is going to create a GDXML file. Go ahead and put in a file path, so that'll be for you. For me, it's C users, one cats, desktop, GDXML. You'll go ahead and put in the path, including the slash, for wherever you put that file. Then this node right here that says Python script, that's something that just exports the GDXML. Now, there's not a built-in node, oddly, for doing that. If you go to the energy analysis for Dynamo, they actually do have a node for, what is it here? Export masked GBXML. Okay, but for getting the detailed information, they didn't. So we created a more general node that will go through and take care of that. And, yes? See, on that machine, is energy analysis loaded in? It is. And what does it say? It says unresolved. I'm trying to think. On that machine, it's just not finding them. We can restart Dynamo again, or let's go to your packages and manage your packages and sort of see if they're in there. It looks like it's there. I almost want to re-download it. It's like something about it just isn't understanding it. Because it should resolve. Either that or I have something where it sort of pops in and pops out. I might just restart Dynamo.
Okay.
Let's see if we can do that. How about you, Ms. Andrew? Is it all in there? Good. Ms. Jacqueline, for you? Okay, looking good. Yeah, they did. Don't know. So super, so they are there, and I bet they're hanging around in here right now. There's something weird, it happens to me too, where sometimes they like disappear.
Yeah,
like.
It was working last time.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay, so we have something, we're gonna export something to GBXML, super. If we wanted to just go ahead and run this part right now without even going through and doing the analysis, we could. We want to see if the file path is actually going to go through and generate a file over here. Okay. In fact, if you want to try that right now, why don't you do this? Just disconnect the part that says the run energy analysis, just because we don't want to actually run it just yet. But if you want to, just try running that and see if you can generate the GBXML file. Okay. What that should do is go ahead and it's giving me some warnings because the downstream stuff is not hooked up right now. But in the watch, it should show you some sort of file path that it generated. Okay, so I have GBML XML automated 1.xml. Okay, you got some sort of path in there too? Super. Okay, if you've got a GBXML path, you know, file, you are ready to upload it and do some analysis on it. Now, just in terms of what's going on in there, there was a paper that John Haymerker's group at Georgia Tech put out, and Mohammed, who did the optimal, they all sort of worked on an example. I just updated it for Revit 2016, so this node is so fresh. It's like, yeah, it's gonna burn your fingers when you pull it out of the oven. It's that hot right now. This just has a few changes in it, but we actually, OnGod started. It was still a little broken because the paper still summarized it as of 2015. They changed some things in the API in 2016. But if you edit that, here's what a little Python looks like underneath us. You're not going to have to get into a whole lot of Python because for the most part, this is what's happening in the nodes behind the scenes, but you have access to everything in the Revit API. And what it looks like is there's all the stuff up front. Okay, which is really the same for every Python node. It's just stuff about accessing the Revit API. Let me even take out all my random comments right here, because I was doing this debugging before coming into class today. Those aren't even necessary. It really is just this. We say transaction manager. That's kind of weird. I'm think an earthquake, but it's not. What's, is it just?
No, I think they're moving something.
Just
yeah, like there's.
Oh, serious?
Yeah.
That's amazing how.
It's gonna be huge.
Yeah, that's some weird vibration.
Yeah.
Okay. Not skipping a beat. Okay, so we're going to make sure we're in a transaction. There's this thing that says we basically have to sort of choose or set up the GBXML export options. We create an energy model. This is the part that was new in 2016. We actually have to explicitly create an energy model. This basically says if there's an energy model already out there, delete it because we want to refresh it. Every time you do this, you want to refresh the energy model. Make sure you have the latest stuff. Okay. It creates the energy model, and then it says doc export, where it's exporting. In zero is what you put in as the file path. In one is what you put in as the file name. So export those things using those GBXML options. Now, if that looks a little confusing and messy, and it is confusing and messy at first, although if you start working with a Revit API, this gets a little more straightforward. But as you look at all that, you just need, if it's working for you, it's super. You know, people who program these sort of nodes get back into looking at this kind of code. But I want to sort of give you the idea that really everything in the Revit API is available to you. Even if you don't have a node that exists today, you can go through and write a custom node like this and get anything that you can find in Revit. Because Revit's it's all defined at the user interfaces drive the API for the most part. They really factored in that way, which is kind of a nice way to do it. Okay, so let me accept those changes. We got our little Python script. You have an XML file hanging out there, right? If you get an XML file, you are ready to analyze it. So what you do is you have to tell it which project you're going to go to. I made it session 19 automated. You can make it whatever you want. It's going to create a project. You should have a number over there that's associated with the project. You pull that into the project ID. You then pull in this path over here. And you're ready to run. Now, let's just take a look at a few of the other parameters of this once. This is the run analysis, energy analysis. Takes project ID, takes a path. Execute parametric runs. That is, do you only want it to consider the one thing, or do you want it to go through and generate all the different options like it did in Rebuilding Studio? By default, that is set to false. So if you don't put a true in there, it'll only evaluate the one thing you're looking at. If you set it true, it'll evaluate all the options. Okay. So I'm going to leave it set to false, because that's pretty good. Timeout's kind of an interesting one. Timeout, it's basically a time period. I don't know if that's like in milliseconds, but basically there's 300,000 of them. I think it's basically considering how long it's going to try to upload the path before it's going to finally say that it's failing on upload. Okay. But for the most part, I'll just leave that set. On the back end of this, we're going to get a run ID. So for the project, when we feed it this path, it'll create a run that will show up in the list. And there'll be a report that just basically says, you know, what was the success or failure of this, if there's some sort of error message. Let's go ahead and try running that for your model. Okay, I think it'll have a new project ID just because the project ID, which gave it a new project name.
My project ID is null.
Is what?
It's null.
Oh, no, that's not good. Let's take a look at that. Project title, let's take a look at what the error is first. You must be logged into Revit. Oh, so in Revit, let's just make sure that you're still logged in. Go ahead and sign yourself in. How are we? Okay, let's just take a look at this. Forbidden. Okay, so the server's returning there. Let's go back and take a look at the beginning part of it in terms of you have an ID. That's okay. You're setting the path to it. It's giving me a run ID, and it says it's successful. Okay, that's good. And what's happening over here? It's still saying, let's go to that one there. Does it still say? It returned an error, forbidden. That's kind of strange. Try running it a second time. I'm just sort of curious. No? Let's see if anyone else gets the forbidden. I didn't get the forbidden, but let's see if anyone else gets the forbidden. You got a forbidden? Interesting. How about you? Is it... Let's think about what this could be.
Are you logged in?
Mm-hmm. Actually, even for me, it gave me some sort of error here. It's telling me couldn't upload the GVXML file name, couldn't run the analysis. Let me see if I can debug my errors as I'm looking at this thing. Looks like I might have a forbidden too. Nope. Well, let's just kind of take a look at it at a time. Okay. My errors are saying couldn't run the analysis for the GBLX on X, try to run the analysis for this file again. Okay. And let's just sort of see what's going on in here. I have GBML XAMated automated one. Could not upload the file name. Set the timeout longer and run again. Let's just go ahead and take a look at sort of what's going on here, because it couldn't upload the file for me. I have that guy there. He certainly looks like a good looking file over there. He looks fine. Let me try that again. Still going to complain. It certainly created the XML file. Execute parametric runs, project ID.
Can you just
try rename
the file?
Oh, okay. Was that again? Oh, try
which
to run.
Which one?
Oh!
Has it
the
file name?
Okay.
I don't know why. I just rename it and it doesn't work. Like, it doesn't work.
Oh,
so it looks like for me, session 19 automated. Well, it looks like actually it did run it finally. It looks like it has an XML file. Huh. So what'd you do, Jacqueline? You just renamed the file?
Yeah.
Okay, no worries. So for example, like you just changed that over here? Let's see, we'll go through and generate that XML file. Okay, this time at least it gave me a run ID and it said it has some success. And now I'm getting the forbidden. Let's kind of think about this. It's supposed to be waiting. Is anyone not getting this? What's that?
It worked when I changed the name.
Ah, interesting. Okay, now the true is all about waiting for the analysis to finish. The 403 forbidden, that's just usually this idea that it's not quite done. Input run ID, I have the run ID. Let me go back over to Green Building Studio. Have a second base run over there. Looks like it did something there. Looks like I have a run ID. Looks like it uploaded in a second. But I'm still getting forbidden. I'm gonna try changing the name of that again. Maybe I'll even try the name of that too. Okay, if you don't have the forbidden, let's go ahead and take a look at what you get. Are you seeing results at the back end? Excellent. Okay, so.
I'm still getting the house view.
Are you still getting the forbidden?
No, I'm getting the house view. I'll just shred it. I want to shred it.
Maybe cool that instead again. Like the.
What that says there. The file doesn't exist. Run energy analysis operation. Oh, you gotta go. Can I get on rated 2?
It says. Well, I've tried changing the name again.
Of this time?
Yeah.
Does this one name have to match?
No, actually, what's gonna happen is. Let's go try changing it to something that's unique there, even in terms of it's yeah, this name and that name are the ones that are sort of like unique. Let me see if it did it on mine, and then let's come back and see if we can solve yours.
Nope.
So I'm running some energy analysis. I'm waiting for it to finish. In that case, it actually worked. So for me, the change seemed to be I created a new project and I created a new file name down there, and it sort of ran. There's nothing I changed about the model, so try these two things. Try changing the run analysis or the project name, and try changing the file name. And see how that works. I'm just gonna get a sense. Jacqueline, did it run for you yet? Okay, pause in, run for you?
No.
Andrew? Okay, and Lemma still not, and Dominique, yes. Okay, let's see if we can sort of figure out the specific cases. So, for Lemma, it says the file does not exist. Go ahead and let's make it like get automated like 3 or 4 or 5, just, you know. Okay, got it. And let's try running that. Oh, you know what it is for you? For you, we need to just go and put the last slash in after GBXML in the file name path.
Wait,
where? Oh, in the file path, it has a slash after the GBXML. It's okay, now try to run it. Okay, so that string right at the end in the file path, when you put it in there, it worked that time?
Yeah.
Okay, try that. It wants to just be a string. String, but give it a really simple string, because I'm worried about whether it's decoding and taking care of all the spaces and stuff like that, right? I'll put the final slash, or the final backslash. Let's see what this says over here. Path is not valid for exporting parameter name folder. So it's users. Don't know. Can we try, as opposed to putting it in a code block, to put it in a string? Like a yeah. Say input string. Okay. Interesting. So in terms of pumping it in, it doesn't want a code block string, which is kind of annoying. It actually just has to be the string function. Okay, but it looks like it did. Okay, then what did it say here? Could not upload the GVXML file name, and so set longer, and, or the pullback, and let's take a look at the name is. Get GVXML2, and let's take a look at the path over here. It's on your desktop, GVXML3. Okay, let's try then, let's just change that name and that name, just because now that we have the kind of infrastructure, right? Yep, let's try it there. Okay, hopefully it'll generate that, put it out on your desktop. Set timeout. Let me think about what's wrong about it. It's because it certainly looks good. Is it actually out there on your desktop? It says it's not able to upload it. So let's take a look. It certainly looks good over there. So I'm trying to think in terms of what's it could not run the analysis for. Set the timeout there. What's happening? Oh, actually. Let's try this. Try running the awesome file again. Let's look at that file. Did you go through and create the volumes? Let's try export. Yes. Okay. So it's complaining to you that it just can't run it because it's basically giving you an error on it. So go ahead and create the volume in Revit. So it's under architecture. Human area. Okay, save volume. Okay, now it'll work. Yep. Okay, so a couple things we learned from some debugging. A, it has to be a string to the Mike code block. B, you have to make sure that the Revit model uploads properly the XML, because it doesn't do a good job of giving you the right error message. It just tells you it couldn't upload it and do something with it. In our case, it wasn't finding a valid volume, so it wasn't doing what it needed to. Okay, this is looking better. Okay, so hence the, please debug it before you get into doing the automation, because if we can't get it to work manually, the error messages you get back are kind of obtuse. Let's take a look at the back end of this. So basically, I get a run ID. I'm gonna wait for the analysis to finish. Take a look at what actually comes out of the back end of this. So if you get the results, and I just look at the building summary, I get the information about the number of people, the lighting power, the typical fan flow, cooling, all sorts of things that are just kind of typically reported at the header of the report. If you go ahead and pull out some specific types of results, for example, I can get the carbon cost summary, the energy carbon cost summary. You can sort of see what the annual energy cost is, the annual energy, it'll report the energy use intensity, the amount of electricity, the amount of fuel, the peak demand, kind of all that stuff. The natural ventilation potential, I tried pulling that down too. But at some point, there's just a lot of information in here that we want to go through and be able to access. So for example, if this is our evaluation, at the end of one evaluation, you want to return the energy use intensity, or you can do whatever you want to do in terms of pulling it out, I would need to go out and grab that number. So we need to figure out how to pull that number out. So in terms of this, let's go ahead and what do I want? Okay, it's kind of the energy results, and what I want to do is it's a number of lists. So I want to get the first list, the first element in that list, and they are a zeroth, zeroth, and the first. It's really the way to look at it. So let's see if we can make this work. It's going to be the zeroth. The zeroth and the first. And Andrew, tell me why that's not going to work, because it probably won't.
I think you need to
Can I not?
Index each bracket, and then that returns the list at the first thing.
So say that again.
It'd be zero, close bracket.
Okay.
And then you close the next bracket, and then you get rid of the next bracket and close brackets.
Oh, really?
So I think that pulls the first list, which is...
And then does this, okay.
And then
so
from the second list, then it pulls the first.
Let's check
index
it.
Index one of the third list.
I like that as a form. That's actually kind of neater. We'll see if it works. Check it out. Thank you, Andrew. The master of all list indexing. Okay, so the zero, and then the first. So this is my energy use intensity for this. Woohoo! Okay, so we now have something that'll go through and do that. And if we now want to go through and do this in a more automated way, what we're gonna do is take all of this stuff and we're gonna wrap it up in a big old node. Okay, and say that that node, you know, it's always going to return the energy use intensity for the current model. So, let's see about doing that. Let me save this away just because I like this so much and I don't want to lose it. Okay. If I want to go through and make a big old node out of that, what I tend to do is actually go through and create a node. And so again, what we've done is we've created sort of really an evaluator function that's going to work on a single instance. Now we've been able to do it on a couple different instances.
I wonder if that's the
The one we go right there.
So let's go ahead and do this. At a high level, what I really want to do is grab all that stuff and put it in a big old node. So if you want to do something like that, what you typically do is just go through and grab it all, then say, create node from selection. Okay, this is going to be, I'm going to call it current model.compute EUI, because that's really what it's going to do. Okay, I'm going to put it in my CEE 120 collection of nodes. Say okay, cross your fingers and hope it doesn't die. Okay. So, there's a lot of stuff in there right now. Getting to delete that little guy over there. Let me go ahead and do this. I'm going to open up my little node there. I'm going to do a little save as because I want to actually not put that in the default directory of the system. I want to put that in my session, in my folder that has everything that, the rest of the examples look, where the rest of the examples located. And let's talk about this node now. So we would like to use this node. At some level, we would like to go through and just sort of see whether or not this can execute and do the same thing if we give it values as plugins and values as outputs. So let me change this node around ever so slightly. Does anyone want this node to work with, or do you all have a node to work with on your own? Put it out there if you want. You have one that works? Okay, so with this node hanging around, there's just a few things I want to do to make it a little more useful for me. One is I want to go through and actually put out, look at all these outputs that are in here right now, and I don't really want all these outputs. Project titles, I'm going to remove that. Project date added, I'm going to remove that. Upload times, I'm going to take out a lot of these things just to make the node a little bit cleaner. Basically, what it did was it put an output on everything that was an open output. If you want to, you can leave these all hanging around here. I guess there's no harm in them. I'm thinking, do I really want to take those all out? Maybe I should leave them on there. There's no harm. Let me close that. I'm not going to save my changes. Let me open it up again. Let me just pull that one out. That's the one that's the most important one. It's this very last one. Because for the output here, that's the part that's going to be energy use intensity. Okay, so I just need to put an output out there. Again, everything else is just sort of passing on through. You can get a rhythm to keep if you want, but I only really care about that one for my purposes. If you keep the others around, you can sort of unpack them a little bit. Okay. We're going to save that. Come back over here. Notice I have energy use intensity over there. That looks pretty good. So what I'm going to do is put a watch on that just so I can sort of see it. What I would like to do now is I just need a way to sort of like actually make this node execute. We can try this by actually just saying run and see if it will, but I'm actually going to put a little input value in there. What I'm going to put in there is like a case number, something like that, and then, or like, yeah, for, yeah, just a run number so that we can basically, if I go through and plug in a bunch of different runs, I can go through and get the energy use intensity for a bunch of them. But let me try just running it and see if it'll run just the way it is. Looks like it's trying something. Let's see what it actually comes up with. I'm just seeing if it's going to do anything. Is it doing anything for you guys, or just kind of sitting there spinning? That's just our thing.
It says null and then on the GreenBlue Studio webpage it tells you that export is running.
Oh, okay, so it might have timed out. Okay, interesting. Let's go back over here. Looks like it's still running over there. Okay, so what it's doing is, I think the null is just because it's still sort of running and it's replacing itself. Let's go ahead and kind of fix this up a little bit more. How about if, as a starting point to this, we give the project name coming into this and we give sort of the run number coming into this as inputs to it. So in that same sense, let's just take the string. I want to distinguish between the different cases. And I'll put another string in there. Okay, so what I'm going to put in this one is 19, I'll say looping, 1. Okay, that's going to be my project name. What I'll do is just rename that node. rename that, this case ID up there. So I'm just going to go through and call this case 10. So what I want to do is I just basically want a way that I can change some things externally and have them go through and report out those values. So back here inside my node, got a bunch of nulls in there. That got a success. That got a null over there. Let's see what's happening. Okay, so over here, what I'm gonna do is, as opposed to going through and feeding in this sort of static name right here, what I'm gonna do is actually just do an input. Okay, this is gonna be the project name string. So I'm going to pop that in, the project title string. So by putting that there, what's going to happen now is I can plug that in and change that pretty quickly. In terms of the case ID, here's something I want. I want to make all these little GDX XML files unique. So what I'm going to do just a little bit is I'm going to set up a loop to go through a bunch of different cases. Okay, and then for each of those different cases, I want to have just a different name of each different run so you can sort of distinguish them all between each other. So what I want to do is take that string and bring it on in, and then concatenate it together with these names. So I'm going to save that away. I'll put another input in here. Okay, this is going to be the case ID string. And what I would really like to do is go through and somehow use those two things together. So sort of take this string and that string and work with them together so that there's a unique string for every different case that I feed on in here. Okay, so to do that, I got a little string over here. I have a string over here. Let's go ahead and I probably have something that does some what I'll call string concatenation or something like that. What that'll do is it'll take a couple different strings and just concatenate them together. So if I go through and take get GDXML automated, okay. So now what's going to happen is it's going to go through and take whatever value we put in and then append it to the tail end of GBXML automated. So I get GBXML automated 10, GBXML automated 11, 12. I save that away. Okay. So this should now, this is our evaluator node for a specific case. We're going to give it a name, we're going to give it a case ID, we're going to go through and run this, and we should have something that's going to come on out. So let's take a look and see if we can get this thing to run. Again, we're still doing it for one case before we set it up in a loop, but if we can get this to work for one case, that loop is very near and dear to us. It's going to happen very quickly. Okay, so let me try running this and see if I can get this to work. If not, we'll debug it, or we'll go through and help debug yours. Okay, it still says null on the back end. Let me sort of figure out why. Looks like 10 is okay, but let's see where we're sort of failing. So it looks like I got the GBXML automated 10. Looks like this says null over here right now. Oh, because the project ID is null. What's happening there? project title string. That says null. What's going on there? I'm creating it on project title. Let's go ahead and put a watch on here just so we can sort of see. So do we have to go through and do that little casting thing where we do this? Is it that thing?
Yeah, or I just type string and then a space bar. That.
Say again? You said
I think you can do it like this, but I just do a tell them is a string, and then we tell them the name of the string. So it's like you put it at the very end, I put it at the very beginning.
Oh.
Without the colon. It's just
I see. So you cast it that way. Interesting. So you say string like that. I think that works either way. Cool.
I don't get the null for the project title string, but I get it for the case ID string.
Let's go and take a look. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and run this per Jacqueline's suggestion right now, and then we'll go back and do your debugging. Hang on. So we'll come back over here. Let's let that run for a second, and let's see what you got. Okay, so you got what do you got going on there? You got a string coming in, case ID string. Okay, and where are you getting your null?
Here.
Oh, let's go ahead, because we need to go through and take the first string, and you can't get it with that one. Let's go ahead and put string in front of case ID string too, just in case, because that looks like that might be a good thing to do. I'm still getting a null over there. Let's see what we got over here. Let's see what we got. Okay, you got that. And it got success. That part's good. So keep going. So where is it finally failing? Okay, and then it says the building summary is null. It's interesting. It said it ran it successfully, but it's not getting the results right. Interesting. And it should be waiting for it. Try running it again. I think this may be a timing thing, but let's go try it again. I'm still getting a null too, so I'm not sure. Let's see if we can figure it out. Andrew, did you get yours to run, or what was happening on yours?
This one, I'm not even sure why it's not working. It got stuck on the upload this time, but it didn't even upload successfully.
Okay.
So I'm trying to use the concatenated string.
Okay, couldn't upload. So somehow my string is bad. Automated. It sure looks like a valid name, but here it says, couldn't upload the GBXML file. I wonder if something is messy about that. It sort of looks like it's doing the right thing. Take care. Okay, let me go ahead and just, again, try and debug it one step at a time. We'll sort of see. I get GBXML automated 10. That looks like it's good there. So in terms of the project ID, take care. We'll see if we can debug this. We got that. We got the project ID. Here it says it couldn't upload the file. Still getting the null on the project title. Let me go back and see what's happening over here. So it's creating session 19, looping 1. It's going through and doing that. Looks like it's still actually running though in the background. Actually, I wonder if for the second time around, since we're already working, if I shouldn't be recreating the levelness in terms of what's going on, if I should just be going ahead and getting the IDs and plugging an ID in there. Because I think that basically, this is saying to create a new project, but I think the project's already created. It might be having troubles there. Let's try this. I'm going to put a watch node right down in here on the project IDs. I'm going to put another watch node on the project titles. Okay, and let's try running this, because I think what I want to do is just grab the first one. This isn't all working flawlessly or seamlessly. We're sort of debugging together in terms of what's going on. But if we can get this one to work, I think this node is going to be very, very useful to a bunch of you. Okay, run completed. Let me go ahead and see, in terms of the debugging, what's happening over here. So in terms of now the project ID, let me go ahead and I'm just going to basically grab that first element. It's interesting now. I think I'm sort of goofing it in that since I make these different project IDs and it's going through and like has two different ones that have the same name and the same number, I think that may be part of why it's so confused in terms of what's going on is I've actually managed to create two different projects with the same title to them. So let's go ahead and just to be sort of really fair about this or to kind of really help it out, go through and say, we'll give it a new name, but then we're going to pull off the first, the zeroth number as opposed to pulling it out there because right now I think the null is coming from the fact that it's failing. So I'm just going to say, I'm going to put a code block in here that says project ID, and I'm going to get the zeroth one. So if I take that and take the zeroth one of that, okay, that's just going to go through and pull the latest one as opposed to trying to recreate that every time. Try running that. Okay, I'll come back to you guys in the front in terms of where you are.
Just watching what you're doing.
Oh, no worries, exactly. I know it gets very confusing. And they don't sort of like play it back.
I got lost at the.
Okay, so let's go ahead and take that. Actually, what I was going to do is. Don, let's go ahead and grab the project IDs right here. Let's grab that one. Great, and pull that in. Okay, so at the node, we put it all in this big old node.
So I have this node, and then I just.
Oh, great. Okay, so this is actually, let's go ahead and change the output title to energy use intensity there. Actually, it won't be the title, it'll be actually in the box itself. Super. I'm going to go back out to, what we're going to do is use that in another project. So, because it really replaces all that. Yeah. Or go to the one that says node.pyf.
Okay.
For that one, let's save as, and save that as, call it like current model.compute energy settings or compute EUI. And we'll sort of see what's happening over here. Let me edit this guy over here. Okay, we did successfully run a model. That was okay. What's happening over here on this side? It says the building summary is null. It says the data is null over there. So let us figure out why the null is happening, because we're giving it basically a run ID. The run ID is there. We're waiting for the results. Enable. Yours worked?
Mm-hmm.
Let's check it out, Dom. Let's see what happens. So it went through, it computed. Oh, fantastic. Check it out. Okay, excellent. Okay, so for this case, this is case 10, you're sort of seeing the total amount of the results there. Okay, great. In terms of actually just pulling out the specific number, the EUI, let's go back in and go to your node again. So, and then over here at the tail end of the node, let's call that one energy use intensity. Yeah. Okay, let's find the other one. What was the other one? And that was another output. Okay, beautiful. Now save that node away. Come back in over here. Okay, now pull in off of this one instead.
Oh.
All right, so I think you're getting the whole results list. Okay. No worries. Let's let it run. I'm not sure why I'm getting the null now, because I'm not getting any errors. It's actually showing that it ran successfully. I'm giving it a run ID. It should be, I would expect, giving me some results. But it's still giving me the nulls right there. So there's a little bit of debugging there to kind of figure that out. But let's go ahead and we'll just change our strategy here in a little bit. I'll try running it for case 11. For each of these different cases, what it should be doing is always generating an XML file. You can see it generated the XML file right there. Then running it instead of sending the results off. Oh, that time it actually worked. So for case 11, I actually got something. Again, I think it's something just with the timing, the power working, with GBS. Okay, so we're able to get a value out. Okay, super. At this point, okay, I'm sorry it's been confusing. Hopefully it'll make more sense when you sort of play it back in the video, and I'll put the finished file back up there. But let's just kind of go through the final step, which is to think about just how we're going to change this and have a whole series of different things that are going to rotate through and kind of keep on changing. What we want to do, for example, is we would like to set up a loop that would go through and compute for several different values. So for this value, we're doing fine. We're getting a 42.4. Let's try changing something about the windows in the model so we can sort of change something, or just change something about the model so we can start to sort of see a difference in the energy use intensity. For example, let's go back over to the model for a second. And if, for example, these windows, which are on the back side, we changed currently, what are they right now? This is a 36 by 72. Okay, so if we change, for example, something like the width of the windows very radically, we would expect that it would have some sort of a change in terms of what's going on. Okay, so let's go ahead and make that change. So here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna go through and basically select a model element. Okay, based on that, we're gonna get the family it belongs to. We then change the parameter. And that's something we did before. Let's just try it. We'll say select element. Oh, what is it? Select edge, select element. Wall type, select family type, element types. Select from list.
Is it select model elements?
Thank you. A model element, okay, great. Well, actually, I'm gonna just do a single one for right now. Okay, because we're gonna change all the ones of the same type. Okay, so let's try this as a starting point. We're going to select a model element. What we're going to do is basically select, choose that model element. So we got that window. Okay. Now for that model element, we want to figure out what family you belong to, or what type you belong to. And I think you found this for me last time, I think. That's the family type. That's the family instance type. Okay, so far so good. And now what I want to do is basically like set a parameter. I want to set a type parameter to the whole thing. Okay, so I'm going to say set parameter by name. And what we're going to go through is figure out which of the different parameters we want to change. In this case, I'm going to take this window. And let's go ahead and change the width of the window. Give it a value. So I'm going to give it a value like, oh, right now it's 3 feet or something like that. Let me just try and change it to 5 feet. So let's start with that as a starting point. We're just going to see, can we go through and change the width of that window to 5 feet as opposed to 3 feet? Okay, now, as we're working, I don't really need all this stuff in terms of the energy analysis down there. So what I'm maybe going to do is just delete or disconnect that, so I'm not worrying about that right now. And let's try running this and see if we could actually change. Super. So you'll notice that all my 3 foot windows became 5 foot windows. Okay, so that's looking pretty good. Let us try this then. If I got a bunch of 3 foot windows and I have a way to change into 5 foot windows, could we actually set up something to kind of iterate through a bunch of different loops? So we can go 1 foot, 2 foot, 3 foot, 4 foot, 5 foot. So what I want to do over here is, as opposed to just sort of feeding that in as a single element of 5, okay, what I'd really like to do is go through and change those like one at a time to a series. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. So that's okay. I just have a series 1 to 5, I'll say to 10, going at one at a time. Okay. Those are going to be my input values. But what I would really like to do is plug those in one at a time over here. And this is the whole thing where now a list map makes sense. Because what we want to do is basically combine this whole like list of values into there and just change them one at a time. So what I'm really going to do is go through and grab all that stuff, put it into a node that just really has the kind of value for the window width. Okay, and then ultimately updates the model every time. So what we do is we have this. This is how you change it for an individual one. If you want to now start changing it for like several of them, what I need to do is basically create a list map and put all this stuff inside of it. So this guy over here, it's going to create this as a group. I'll say, this is my list of test input values. Okay. What we're going to do in this block over here is go through and set the model, and then we're going to evaluate the model. So what I'm going to do over here is I'm going to take all those. I'm going to create a node from those. Okay, this is going to be current model, set window width, okay, let me edit that node. What's going to happen is every time we go through and run this, we want to have an input to it. Actually, I'm going to do another input out here just so I can pass in the element. Now, as we're changing this element, there's only one important thing we have to do to make sure that we're always grabbing it and just finishing before we complete. And what we have to do is this. We have to put a transaction start and a transaction end after it. That way we know that it actually did change it. So it's going to say transaction start. And then we're going to do a transaction end on the other end. And here's how it looks, is basically we go through and we pass in an element. We then say, super, for this element, I want you to get the family type and set the parameter. And then at the end, I want you to pass out the element after it's completed the transaction. So that's just a really common structure. We do that a lot. Whenever you need to change a Revit model, oops, I'll put it up there. We pass an element to change, we transaction start it, we change the element, we transaction ended, then we pass the element back out. In this case, we're going to pass in the windows. So again, don't worry if it's not on your screen right now, but let's just kind of conceptually kind of think about it, that sort of makes sense. That you take an element, you sort of pass in the value you want to change it to, then you basically say you're going to set the parameter. Do you understand about the transaction start and the transaction end, what I'm up to there, in terms of always needing to make sure that the element does change? Does that make sense?
So does that just initiate it
and then exactly. It sort of says, hey, open it for change, make a change, close the change, and wait till you finish changing. Okay, so that's what that's all about. Go ahead and save this as, I'm also going to put this in my same folder just so I can find it. And again, what I'll do is after at the end of class here, I'll put all this stuff into a folder for you guys so you can have that as an example. Okay, so I've got a node that's going to change the window width. I pass it a width, and I pass it an element to change, and now we go through and do that. So let's go back over here. We have this little node. Okay. I'm going to put that select model element back in here. Okay, so the element of which I'm going to change all the ones of the same type is here. For the width, here's where the list map comes in. In the list map, what I would really like to do is not just sort of change it to one of those values, I'd like the list map to go through all those different values. So we'll say list map. I'll feed it that function. Okay. What this is going to do is go through and from 1 to 10, just going to make all those windows bigger and then I'm going to change them one at a time. Does that sort of make sense? So let's watch that run for a second. That sort of makes sense as it went. Okay. So again, starting with 1. Okay. So we got the inputs. We're changing the inputs. All we need to do now is find a way to go through and figure out for each of those different steps what was the energy use intensity that was associated with it. Okay. So that's where we kind of finally put the last piece together. We're going to take this guy over here. Okay, and all this stuff which is over here about computing the EUI and that and the K-string, that's going to get, what we're actually going to do is put it together into the same node where we're going to go through and basically take that element, make sure it's transacted, and then we're going to go through and compute the EUI over time. And the way to do that is we just have to go back into this one. Actually, even there, I got a list of the elements out there. Da, 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 da. I'm trying to think if I want to put it all in the same node or put it in two different nodes. Because really what I want to do is get that element over here and pass it over there. Let me do it a different way, which is the way I've done in the past that actually sort of works is put together something called function compose. Final confusing concept for today, anyway. What I'm going to do is take that function. Okay. And then I'm basically going to go through and take this function. What I'm going to do is just run them one after the other. That can be good there. That can be good there. Actually, interestingly, what I really want to do in terms of the case string is actually just go through and feed it the same. It's basically the case ID. So what I should do here.
What did you
look? I will test this, after class here, because we're just going to end in just a second. I think what I'm going to do is take this guy over here. Okay, and I'm going to go through and as a second output, again, we're sort of doing this as we go, so I could have a little problem in here, but we'll figure this out. I'll take the window width, I'll pass it right on through. Because what I want to do is back over here, take that window width, which is the output of this thing, and basically pass it in as the input to here. So in theory, what's going on here, although I think I need to sort this a little bit here, I'm going to take the window, and from 1 to 10, I'm going to change and set the window width. At the tail end, I'm going to basically pop out where the resulting window width was. It's going to get passed on down to this function. It'll get passed in as the case ID string. Okay, so the first case will be 1, the second case will be 2, the third case will be 3. So what it's going to do is basically for every model, for each of those different cases, it's going to compute the EUI kind of at that point. Okay, and just rotate through and kind of like go through the entire list one at a time, hopefully going through and evaluating all 10 cases. Okay, in terms of, let me just do this here, so it's on the video, but I'll also go through and I'll confirm this and send something out. I think I may need one other thing. It's a get parameter value by name. The only reason I'm doing this is what I want to do is I want to make sure that before it passes a value out as the case ID, that it's always waiting to make sure that the thing is updated. That way, it won't go through and do the energy use analysis until the window is actually updated. So, even over here, case ID, save that away. Come back over here. So for each of these different things, we will go through and we'll start with a window width. It's going to pass out a case ID, which is just going to be the same as the window width. It's going to take that case ID on in. It's going to go through and put out an energy use intensity. So the result of this function compose is that it's going to go through, and for each different item in the list, it's going to do this and then do that, ultimately returning the EUI for each of those different cases. Okay, so we will test that and keep on debugging in terms of trying to make sure that is actually working out okay. But that is the form that really a lot of the different things that people are working on is going to take. It's going to be something like that if you're using the energy use intensity. Now, if you're not doing something as complicated as that, and it really is just that you're computing something geometric, there's easier evaluator functions. But this is actually kind of a complicated one. But the idea is always set the Kernel model, do the transaction, and then based on that, go through and do the EUI. Now, in some of the examples that are already out there, just so you know, in some I have done it so it's not under function compose. What happens is I'll just actually put the node right in here. So after that, I'll just take that value, and as opposed to outputting it there, I'll say current model. My 120 things. That's funny about why they're, this thing's a little broken today. Our current model. What I'm trying to do is basically just pull that one in. So basically just take this node right here and actually put it inside that node. There's really, I don't think, a whole lot of difference about whether I sort of put it at the tail end using the compose function, or if I take that node and I bury it inside of that. Although I kind of like it this way a little bit better because it's a little bit clearer that first you're setting and then you're giving. So I'll come back over here, and this is basically to input parameters for each case. Evaluate and return results for each case. Wait until set transaction is ended. So that's if you sort of think about it at a high level, what's going on. This set the model and the input parameters, evaluate and return the results, but always wait. That's what the function compose is doing. It's basically causing it to wait to the next one so that it won't actually evaluate this until case ID is passed out. And case ID isn't passed out until transaction is ended. Make sense? Okay. And then it's a lot of stuff in there in terms of trying to digest and put it all together. But how about if we do this, just in terms of kind of getting yourself ready? Yeah, for Thursday and stuff. We will be here tomorrow for a lot of office hours, as you might expect. In terms of the office hours tomorrow, let's see what's going on in there. So I won't do Sandy in the morning. Let's just say I'm going to be here till probably around 3 o'clock in the afternoon tomorrow. Okay? Let's say, since we expect a lot of action, let's say at 9. Okay, so from 9 onward, we'll be hanging out here. And really, we'll devote most of our time to the 120 folks, because I think, or 220 folks, because I think you guys are the ones that could use the most help in terms of pulling it all together. So we'll prioritize your questions over the 220D questions. Sure, send me upstream. Or up the river. Okay, so go ahead, and if you can, if you can go through and get your Revit model looking good so it's able to flex it. So if we set some parameters, things will happen in the Revit model. I can help you set up the whole notion of really how we do the transaction start, the transaction end, and then bringing this like evaluation function back in there.
Could you upload this?
I will upload this right now so you have this as well as the video, because I know there's a lot of stuff going on there. And honestly, you know, this was a very experimental session. We were kind of just going and kind of putting it together as we were kind of learning. So I'll put this all up there for you so you can go ahead and have a look at that. Okay, let us adjourn for today. Oh, actually, same model. Inputs. Flex the Revit model by setting parameter by name, transaction start, transaction end, evaluate spell wrong. Let's map it all together. So that's the essential form. If you can sort of get that picture in your mind about how that flow works, the rest of it will sort of become a lot easier. Okay, let us adjourn.